Welcome to the official 2024 VBridger rigging tutorial. I'm the Art Gun. I'm one of the creators of VBridger. I created all of the default settings files that are included with VBridger, as well as the original tutorial from 2022 on how to rig for it. Live 2D has updated a lot since then. We have blend shapes now, which is cool, as well as some other tools. So this updated tutorial will show you how to rig for VBridger with all of the most recent and cutting-edge techniques. We'll be splitting the tutorial into distinct parts. Part one, which is this video, will just cover art preparation and organizing the Live2D file in preparation for rigging. Part two will cover the eyes and eyebrows. Part three will cover the mouth, jaw, and cheeks. Part four will cover the tongue. And part five will cover adding head angles to the whole mix. We've tried to keep these tutorials fairly beginner friendly. It's always frustrating when a tutorial skips over in-depth explanations of tools and such. So we've done our best to keep everything in, though it might be redundant for more experienced users. Getting to the meat and potatoes of this video, we'll start in Paint Tool Sai and I'll show you all my layers, then I'll import the PSD into Live2D and organize the Live2D file for rigging. This video is mostly about preparation, so the actual rigging will come after. So here is Paint Tool Sai. You'll see I have a single parent folder. This just keeps everything organized in Live2D, in my opinion. If you're adding other files, such as the Live2D head angle guide, to your project, having all of your art in one folder is very nice. All my folders have the F_ prefix. This is to prevent name ID issues in Live2D. I'll show you when we get there, but everything that imports into Live2D has a name and an ID. By default, as long as your layer or folder's name doesn't contain spaces or symbols, or being a duplicate of another name, it will import with the same name and ID. Adding a prefix saves us from a very specific headache that you may have come across before, where you could not name a parameter for some reason. This is common with emotes, as artists might name a folder emote_stars. If the rigger tries to name a parameter emote_stars, they will discover that they can't. This is because the folder has already used that ID, and we want IDs to be correct on our parameters because they show in VTS and internally are used by Live2D. You likely won't run into it often, but if you can't name a parameter ID the way that you want despite not having another parameter named that way, this is probably why. Folder hierarchy is mostly personal preference and whatever works best for your art style and the model that you're working on. I usually keep my face, like all my eyes, my nose, my mouth, all in one folder just so it's easier to find. When it comes to rigging VBridger mouths, it works best to use inverse clipping. Regular clipping has problems when making some of the mouth shapes. My orange mask_top lip mask there covers the top of the mouth, and the green mask_bottom lip mask covers the bottom of the mouth. The art is cut flat at the edges, right where the center of the end of the lip lines are. This is so we can move the mask from the mouth corner without having like a few pixels at the corner that are unchanged. So having it end before the line ends gives us more freedom. If you have lipstick, I recommend separating it out onto its own layer like I have here. It'll make rigging the mouth a lot more fun and a lot easier. If you have lipstick, you want an extra mask. So this is on the inverse side of the lower lip. I called it mask_INV_bottom lip because it's the inverse of the other mask. This will allow us to hide the bottom lipstick more effectively, and it gives us lots of freedom when rigging. So the lower lip will never be visible above the lower lip line, which is accurate and what we want. Tongues! Tongues are notoriously difficult, and we have a new technique for you. In order to use it, you need to draw your tongues in a specific way. Draw the full tongue tip to where it vanishes at the back of your character's mouth. Draw it flat without perspective or deformation. You don't want to draw it, like, even if you have like a three quarters model or something, draw it flat. Like flat view from above. Then what you want to do is you want to duplicate the layer and cut off the tip. The place where you cut it is important. So imagine if your character bit their tongue off with their lips. That's where you want to cut your art. If you have multiple layers to your tongue, you need to duplicate all of them and cut them all in the same spot. You cannot use regular clipping for your tongue, so if you are using clipping masks, you need to convert them to inverse masks. That's easy, you just select inverse and make a mask of the invert of the layer. You got it. If your style uses lines, you want to add a line layer behind the tip layers. If you don't use lines, you don't need a line layer, of course, up to you. Inner mouth. If you are using a tongue line, it will also be necessary to make a inverse mask of your upper teeth. This mask needs to be pixel perfect. It will make the tongue line only appear when the tongue is in front of the upper top teeth. It's mostly just to clean it up and make it look better. Otherwise, my teeth layers are pretty uncomplicated. I only have one layer for the top teeth on top of everything else. My lower back teeth are split into the left and right. The tongue sits on top of those, and my lower front teeth sit on top of the tongue. I've drawn the jaw slightly ajar rather than completely closed. This is just to get a smoother curve on the lower back teeth. I want more pixels than I'd get if I drew it flat. We'll put it in place later when we're rigging, it'll be fine. My eyebrows are super simple, single layers, nothing special is needed for V-Bridger. Nose is also super simple, just a line and a highlight and a blush layer, nothing crazy. My eyes are also fairly standard, except I'm using an inverse mask for them as well. I find it convenient as you can make the inner eye fully vanish, which you can't while using a standard mask. If you cross your inverse mask over itself, it'll just hide everything inside of it. Whereas for a regular mask, you have to like crunch it all the way down, and then you still technically have a thin line of visible inner eye, and then you just have to hide that underneath your eyelids. I don't like crunching masks, so I use an inverse mask instead. For the head itself, I have three layers, the blush, the fill, and the backline. Backline just sits behind the fill layer, blush clips to the fill layer using a regular clipping group. All of my clipping masks are at 0% but are visible. This is so that in Live 2D I don't have to re-enable them to use them, as in Live 2D if your mask is disabled, it doesn't mask anything. So I don't want to have to turn all those on again. So I just have them on and at 0%. That covers all of the art, so let's get this PSD imported to Live 2D. It's all ready. We can just drag and drop the PSD into Live 2D while we have no project open to start a new project. Live 2D will auto-generate some parameters and load all the layers as art meshes, which we can see all on the leftmost deformer menu. It's really hard to find anything like this, so I like to organize these objects into deformers. It doesn't matter if you use rotation or warp deformers, they won't be getting rigged either way. This mimics our folder setup and makes the project easier to navigate. I'm just going to grab the layers from our main folders and add a warp deformer with the suffix _org. I'm clicking continuous creation so I can continue selecting more objects and adding deformers without the menu disappearing. So I'm just grabbing all them layers in the folders and adding a warp deformer to them. Once I have my org deformers organizing my face layers, I'll select them and add a rotation deformer parent to control the whole head. Since I'm just making a floating head for this tutorial, the benefits to strict organization are less obvious, but I promise rigging is much smoother when you organize these things prior to getting into the details. I also like to have a main rotation deformer as the root of all my model meshes and objects, so I'll just add that at the top. I call it model. Now that our art meshes are organized, I'm going to organize our parameters. This is fairly simple, we're just adding folders to the defaults that Live2D has given us. So starting with head angles, I'm creating a head angle folder which will contain angle X, Y, and Z. Then eyes will contain eye open L through eyeball Y. Then brows will contain brow L and R Y, but nothing else. We're gonna delete those later. They're not necessary for this style of rigging. If you use them, go ahead, but I'm not going to. Then we'll create a mouth folder and put mouth open and mouth form in here. Lastly, body. The body angle parameters and breath will go in here. This should leave the leftover brow params and some default hair parameters that we won't be using. I'm gonna delete them all. Next, I'll be moving the org deformers in the hierarchy. I want them all in one place because these are special deformers that won't be doing anything, and I want them somewhere easy to delete. So I don't want them nested all in these little folders all over the place. The last step to having this model ready to rig would be to apply the masks. So I'm starting with the inner mouth, which is masked by the upper and lower lip masks. I'm selecting the upper and lower lip masks and hitting Ctrl C. I can then go to all of the inner mouth layers and in the clipping ID box, I can click on it and hit Ctrl V. This will paste the IDs of the objects I copied. This is the most convenient way to apply masks and the most efficient. If you're using the Live2D menu, it will reload the masks every time you make changes, which is very inefficient if you have a large model. It can take up to a minute to load at times, depending on how heavy your model is. So applying all the masks at once and not hitting enter or clicking out of the clipping box is the most efficient way to handle the masks. I'm also going to check the inverse box for our inner mouth masks so it's working properly. Next, I'll mask the lower lip and lower lip line by mask underscore upper lip and check the inverse box. Then I'll add mask underscore INV underscore bottom lip, the blue mask, to the bottom lip. This will mask out the lipstick itself, so we're not adding it to the lip line at all. The upper lip is still crossing the upper line, so I'll add the upper lip mask to its clipping group as a regular mask. You can see when I move the lip layers, the lower lip is never visible above the upper lip, and the lips themselves never cross past their lip lines. This will allow us to roll the lips inward, push them out, and move them all around without having any crossover or issues. It makes our mouth super flexible, which is required for V-Bridger. For the tongue clipping, the upper lip mask will inversely clip the tip of the tongue and the tongue line, if you're using it. We'll add the inner teeth mask to the tongue line as well. And we will use the upper and lower lip masks for the whole tongue layer. Then we'll organize the tongue layers so the tongue tip and line go under the top lip. The whole tongue layer goes under the top teeth. The result of all of our tongue masking allows us to move the tongue around. If it crosses over the upper teeth, we get the line, so it looks nice and clean, even though it is technically clipping through the teeth. And if it goes below the bottom lip, it breaks, but we don't care about that because it'll never go below the bottom lip. And if it goes under the upper lip, it just vanishes, so. all situations are accounted for and it is good to rig. Our eyes are still hella unclipped, so I'm copying the eye mask, selecting all the inside parts, and pasting the mask in the clipping ID. I'm clipping left and right separately. VTube Studio lets us break the usual limit on clipping groups, which I think is like 64 or something. If I wanted to keep this more optimized for other applications, I'd probably add the left and right masks to both eyes, and do that for all left and right masks, because it would save me... it would half the amount of masks I would need, basically. Lastly, I am masking the blush to the head with a regular mask. All of our masks are applied, we're looking cute, we're looking organized, we're looking ready to dive into actual rigging, so I will see you in part 2.